went through and you said we figured out how to do this, right? Was this like a, you got on Google and started YouTube and videos about planting trees, about establishment? Like what was your, like how did, were you the one who came up with the technical idea of like the whole processing or like planting, and how'd that work?
Yeah, that's a great question. And no, we actually hired a consultant who designed not only the species selection, but the areas on the ranch in which we planted. There were some complexities in working with a consultant. The consultant actually wasn't from our area, which I think is common. Like, you know, I'm zooming in from California to you all. I think that's just a example of how few and far between these silvopasture projects actually are. So it was actually really challenging to find a consultant who could help us. You know, California is a Mediterranean climate. Like I mentioned, we do have a oak savanna, which is a type of silvopasture already here, but the type that we were attempting to establish didn't really have precedent, which maybe should have been a red flag when we designed the project. But, you know, I think I was really inspired by some of what I was learning sort of theoretically about the benefits of silvopasture. So the consultant worked with us based off of our existing enterprises, which is we run a pasture raised meat business. So we raise poultry, turkey, specifically turkeys and chickens. And then we graze ruminants, cattle and sheep. And then we also have a swine enterprise with our hogs. So we wanted to augment all of those different systems with the integration of trees. And I sort of touched on it in the video, like each design was sort of inspired by an enterprise, right? Like one area was meant to provide fodder specifically for ruminants, another for pigs, you know, the integration of poultry with shade and other attributes there seemed really great. So that was like the high level approach. In the actual implementation, the part of this agreement with the consultant was that they would actually help us plant the trees. So they came out and actually brought a planter that, I don't know if you've seen this before, but it's literally a pull behind in a tractor, and you sit on a little seat, and you actually bend over, and as it's creating, you know, a little tillage row, you plant your tiny tree. And when you're planting 6,000 trees, you really need that level of efficiency to get the planting in the ground. So the agreement was the consultant helped us design, procure the species, and plant the trees. And then my farm team and I helped lay the irrigation, stake the trees, put the cardboard protector over the tree, and then place the mulch around the tree, which was pretty much what we did in 2021, before the seven plagues occurred. So yeah, but how did it work with you? It sounds like the technical assistance came from NRCS.
Yeah. And my wife calls me Tom Sawyer sometimes. So we managed to find some church groups who came out and planted all our trees for us.
Perfect.
We dug the holes ahead of time, and yeah. I almost got him to pay me to do it. So it was like, that was a good experience. It was worthwhile for them, meaningful. We got to talk through. They still come back to our farm and they're like, hey, I planted that tree, which is fun. But I also realized there's probably some issues there in terms of like planting, acumen. Although like there were some people there who were papers, and they taught me a lot about planting trees, so that worked all right too. What's like when you were talking though, I was hearing the reasons you were doing like some of these things. So I was thinking through the reason I want to do silvopasture, like very similar reasons, but it all came from my grandpa. It was really like this grump 90-year-old who literally his advice to me is I'll sell bulldozers in 20 years. if you plant trees. So, but he's like, you can't have sheep on our farm. We don't have any shade, right? It's like, you can't have sheep. You don't have any grass. You can't have sheep. And it's over and over and over. The things I really enjoy about the Silvopasture community, is there a backup mic just in case? But the Silvopasture tree community is like, I spent my time as a row crop farmer trying to figure out how to kill things. Like if something's in my field, I want to get rid of it. I can do that with a chemical, and I can kill like what I don't want in there. I think the fun thing for me and the addicting thing about planting, like using trees and using plants to solve long-term problems, is that I get to figure out how to make things live to solve problems. And it sounds like you're kind of doing the same thing, like long-term. It's just, for me, it's just really addicting.
I share that sentiment. The olive trees in particular feel like a multi-generational investment. I mean, I think the saying goes, you plant an olive tree for your grandchild. So, I mean, it may take that long to really become profitable with the olives, but I find that of all of the things that grow on the ranch, I go out and check on my silvopasture trees probably the most. Like, I mean, obviously we tend to the animals daily, but like what I sort of like go and want to see the progress of are these trees. Like I love taking my coffee out in the morning to certain parts of the planting and just like sort of being there with them in the morning. And there's something really cool about that. I mean, I don't know how else to describe it besides sort of how you described it, which is like, there was no kind of intervention here except for like human inspiration to get these trees planted. Like we as like a community talked enough to like get someone excited about the potential of these trees. And then we did this crazy thing. Like it's just, it is really sort of a fun, it is a fun project. And for that reason, I'm really glad that we did it.
As you were talking about that, I was like, so like the other thing, I don't like to kill things now. I also am trying to figure out how not to use machinery. I found out yesterday I can use oxen to do pretty much everything I want to do on the farm. Anyway,
yeah.
Not so faster.
Yeah.
So you mentioned an olive tree. You plant them for your grandkids, right? I also know we talked before and you farm with older people, older family members. A family member of your generation, like I'm in the same situation. I have farmed with, he's 95 now, still loves on the farm. We still give him the daily updates. And I also farm with my sister who's about my age, and little kids around. So trees are a multi-generational thing. Like I can walk away from corn crop anytime, right? At end of the year, done, out, if I want to. Can't do that with trees. How is the people side of this, like the intergenerational, like the people side, how does that affect your silvopasture planning?
You know, it was funny because when we were first approached by the B Corp with the funding potential, it was like mid 2020, so it was like very sort of early in the pandemic. And I remember being like, I think as many of us were, very sort of like stir crazy. And I think that the scale of this project was sort of insane. And I do credit some of that insanity to like COVID era energy. But I remember approaching my parents and I was like, we're on lockdown. Like we could use this time to plant trees. Look, it's perfect timing. And they were sort of like, okay, like, but what about, you know, the financial aspect? So I, you know, introduced them to the B Corp. We sat down and looked at the funding opportunity, you know, what it wouldn't cover, what it would cover. And I think, you know, from their perspective, they see this ranch as a carbon sink, a long-term place for biodiversity. You know, that is their passion as well. So the tree element spoke to them in the fact that I think they felt like they were providing the opportunity for my generation to benefit from the enhanced ecosystem services that would follow from the project. So I think they were on board, really. I mean, it wasn't challenging to get them to understand the ecological aspects, but I know that that's not always the case. I'd say that we may be sort of in a unique situation, which, you know, my parents sort of prioritize that that element of the property. But I'd love to hear the same from you. I mean, what was it like talking with your family about it?
Well, let's just say they weren't quite so supportive. We had like our chestnut deal for our chestnut planting. We had 3 equip contracts that we got all the way to the kitchen table. We're going to sign this contract, ready to go. And my grandpa nicks it each time. Like, just there, next year, do it again. Next year, do it again. And again, it was, you know, and I think the people side of farming is interesting because my grandpa saw it as a threat. Like, we end up, we put our chestnut orchard, like, we were planting this. My grandpa's, you know, out there helping me put mulch in. He's out there crying, right? And turns out that when he moved to the farm in 1950, he rented from a guy who had an apple orchard in the exact same spot. And my grandpa killed it with 2,4-D the first year he was there, right? He's like, get rid of that thing. And then this whole pasture that we just put in with all the silvopasture, like with the trees that we have planted, with the windbreaks, everything like that, that was all there when he came. And he ripped it all out. He got Conservation Farmer of the Year in 1968 for putting in terraces and ripping out pasture. And so, like, who he was, who he had done, he's like, what did I do to get this stupid grandson who wants to take, you know, get rid of my corn and soy and plant trees, right? And there's a lot of really hard stuff that goes into that. But, you know, but the good thing is, like, my sister's around. And you talked about COVID. My sister's a teacher. She was a teacher. I used to be a teacher. COVID hit, her school shut down. We were building fence like ahead of, we started off with 200 ewes, 15 acres that we built, and we just kept building fence like ahead of the ewes where they were moving to. Right. And so she came and she learned to love to build fence in the summer of COVID. And that's what caused her to want to farm. And so it's fun because like we see the world the same way. Like, you know, we're almost kind of hippies, like, you know, but so we want to sequester carbon. We want to take care of animals, and we want to do that by bringing life. Right. And so it's nice that we're kind of on the same page, but like the row crop older generation, it's been really tough. I think for us though, like, he's stubborn. I'm not stubborn. Of course not. So he's stubborn, I'm stubborn, but I think in a good way. Like, I think we both just kind of decided, and it's a different value system. It's like, I'm not going to leave you. You're not going to, like you can't leave me because you can't drive anymore. But it's like, we're not going to leave each other. We're stuck here. We care for the land. And no matter how mad you get at me and how mad I get you, we're going to be here because we care about each other. And I think, like, for me, that's just like, that's a really, it's countercultural, especially where we are, maybe, I don't know, maybe where you are too.
No, we're definitely the weirdest ones on the block for sure.
I'm glad you are too.
Well, that's a really special story though, with your grandpa. And, you know, I think beyond all of the actual, you know, ecological and physical attributes that the planting brings, I do think that that's a huge part of it, is just like being that kind of iconoclast who is not following the norms of your community, maybe, or the agricultural practices of your community. It takes a certain amount of bravery and, you know, gumption to do that. So I really respect that you did that where you are, in your context.